The time is now 11:30, so I am just going to get started with some housekeeping items. I'm sure more people will trickle in as we get started here today. If you have not done so already, please introduce yourself and your practice in the chat. That'll help with attendance purposes, but it also helps everyone else on the webinar kind of get to know you a little bit. So my name is Bridget Sweeney, and I am the training coordinator for the Maryland Addiction Consultation Service, which is kind of what Max for Moms is housed under, and I'll get a little more into the Max for Moms details in a second. As you may have noticed when you logged in today, your camera and your microphone are both disabled for the duration of today's training. We do ask that you put questions and comments into the chat throughout today's training to communicate with us. If for whatever reason you cannot use the chat, I do ask that you email them over to me and I'm happy to read those out to our consultant today. To receive credit for today's webinar, you will receive an email to the evaluation that'll be sent to the email that you registered with. So just make sure, even if you logged on with a different email today, that you check that one that you originally registered with. Once you complete that survey, please give us 1 to 2 business days to process your attendance and send your certificate over. If you have any questions about this process or also want some more information about mom services, please feel free to reach out to any of those emails. You'll also receive a copy of the slides following today's presentation, and a recording of the webinar will be available on the Max for Moms website within 1 business week. Now I'm going to get a little more into our Max for Moms services. So as I mentioned before, Max for Moms is a part of the Maryland Addiction Consultation Service, but the MOMS part stands for Maternal Opioid Misuse. And Max for Moms supports maternal health providers in addressing the needs of their pregnant and postpartum patients with substance use disorders, particularly opioid use disorder. And Max for Moms is an expansion of the Maryland Addiction Consultation Service, which is a statewide program that is free for all providers. Since we are state funded, all of our services are free. And those services include a warm line that's open from 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. And I'll be sure to put that contact information into the chat. But how our warm line works is when you call, you'll be connected to a behavioral health consultant who will gather some more information about what you would like to discuss with one of our consultants. You then can provide some de-identified information specifically about your patients. And then we connect you to a consultant who will walk you through how best to treat that patient and kind of hear more about what you've done to treat them and how you can improve. We also offer educations and trainings such as today's webinar. Usually our webinars are around the lunch break, so you can log on during the workday, but we also offer waiver trainings in both the half and half and full 8-hour formats, and we do that through PCSS. I can put some more information about our upcoming trainings in the chat as well. And we something else that we offer similar to educations and trainings is our tele-echo clinics. Our mom's tele-echo clinic is the second Tuesday at 8 a.m. of every month. And during that time, a group of members of the learning community, such as yourself and people similar to you, come with cases from their own patient load, and they present on that patient once again with de-identified information. Then they get feedback from the learning community as well as a panel of our consultants, and that is paired with a didactic presentation from one of our consultants. So that's another great way to get continuing education credit while also improving your own practice. And I can put more information about that in the chat as well. Now I am going to introduce our presenter today. Our presenter today is Dr. Lorraine Milio, and she is an assistant professor in Johns Hopkins Medicine Department of Gynecology and Obstetrics. She serves as obstetrical director and obstetrical consultant for the Center for Addiction and Pregnancy. And Dr. Milio's areas of clinical expertise include endocrine disorders of pregnancy and HIV and pregnancy. Dr. Milio is a fellow of the American Congress of Obstetricians and Gynecologists and a member of the Society for Maternal Fetal Medicine. She's board certified in gynecology and obstetrics, maternal fetal medicine, and addiction medicine. And Dr. Milio is a recipient of the Johns Hopkins Service Excellence Award. And we are lucky enough to have Dr. Milio on our consultant board for Max for Moms. So, Dr. Milio, I will turn it over to you for today's talk. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. So today I'm speaking on the role of prenatal care providers in caring for pregnant women with substance use disorder. And my specific aims are to discuss just understanding the goals of screening, documentation, and referral, how routine prenatal care should or should not be modified for this population, how to establish communication with the opioid use disorder treatment providers and other service providers, and then lastly, handling the unstable patient. And my goal is to be very practical, but also to provide a basis for the various recommendations. So, as you're aware, the opioid epidemic has worsened, especially during the COVID epidemic and pandemic. And when I did this slide last year, it had nearly 841,000 people have died since in the US since 1999 from a drug overdose. It's now closer to a million. And in 2019, depending on how they looked at the year, between 70 and 78,000 drug overdose deaths occurred in the US, with over 100,000 occurring between May of 2020 and April of 2021, which was an increase of almost 30% from the prior year. And unfortunately, since 2010, drug overdose deaths have been a leading cause of maternal mortality across the US and in Maryland. So I'm just going to talk about some terms and definitions. So in general, we refer to opioid use disorder or OUD and substance use disorder as SUD. And I just want to go through a couple of definitions because I think it's understanding the definitions really is goes a long way to understanding how to approach the disease. And NIDA back in 2010 first came up with the definition of drug addiction as a compulsive drive to take a drug despite serious adverse consequences, and described it as a chronic relapsing brain disease that is characterized by compulsive drug seeking and use despite harmful consequences. And the American Society of Addiction Medicine back in October of 2019 sort of refined that definition. And I like the way they integrate the definition. And they talk about addiction as being a treatable chronic medical disease involving complex interactions among brain circuits, genetics, the environment, and an individual's life experiences. People with addiction use substances or engage in behaviors that become compulsive and often continue despite harmful consequences. No two addicts, but patients with addiction or substance use disorder are exactly alike because of this complex interaction that varies from patient to patient. Drug dependence is a separate definition, and dependence actually develops when neurons adapt to repeated drug exposure and only function normally in the presence of the drug. And so when the drug is withdrawn, several physiologic reactions occur that are collectively known as withdrawal symptoms. And these can range from mild, as in caffeine, or to life-threatening, as for alcohol or benzodiazepine. And so even though prolonged use of opioid drugs change brain structure and function, resulting in drug dependence, addiction may or may not be present. An excellent example of this are patients who have sickle cell anemia, and many of them have been on a lifetime of opioid medications that often are increased or need to be increased during the patient's 20s and 30s. And these very few of these patients actually have issues with opioid use disorder, and yet very often when they present to the in the healthcare system, they are immediately assumed to have opioid use disorder because they do have opioid dependence. So it's really important to separate those two things out. And what happens in chronic opioid use? There are changes in the neuronal cells in the brain. And so the opioid user really struggles with recovery and involves overcoming the effects of these changes. And so, in general, when patients will take methadone or buprenorphine, they actually are taking it to feel more normal, certainly not to get a high. So the next part is just understanding what the goals of screening, documentation, and referral are. So in screening for opioid use disorder, substance use disorder, I would emphasize the importance of universal screening, regardless of the method chosen. Versus patient profiling or no screening. And since we know that opioid use disorder cuts across all socioeconomic groups and ethnic groups, patient profiling is going to limit your evaluation of the patient. And I know I was speaking at one hospital and they said, well, they didn't do universal screening, but they screened for 25 different reasons. Doing universal screening is just so much easier. Having a mechanism in place for a positive screen is important, so you know what to do when you have a positive screen. First, it's important to have a discussion with the patient about the positive screen. And also deal with false positives. There can be cross-reactivity with other meds or food, especially if you use urine screening. The initial screen is usually considered exactly that, a screen and not diagnostic. And for instance, if someone has a poppy seed roll right before doing a urine test, it can come up positive for morphine. Some HIV meds can be a false positive for cannabis. So one has to be aware of some of the cross-reactivity. A brief intervention, which I'll talk about a little bit later on as well, where the provider actually sits down and talks with the patient about the effects of the of whatever substance the patient has tested positive for, and its effect on the pregnancy. And this is actually separately billable and in addition to whatever visit you are doing. And there are specific codes for that. And then also having mechanisms in place to refer for further evaluation or treatment services. So when to screen. Most practices will screen at the time of the nurse history or initial prenatal visit. But it's also recommended to consider rescreening in the early third trimester for a couple of reasons. First of all, the patient is often more comfortable with the practice, the providers, the staff, once they get further into the pregnancy. And also, you may also pick up relapses which may have occurred since the first prenatal visit. And then many hospitals will screen on admission for delivery. And then, there's a question as to how appropriate is it to screen on triage visits as well. I would say as appropriate. An example was I've seen cases where patients were in triage and sometimes had a couple of triage visits for severe nausea and vomiting that were attributed to the pregnancy and turned out to be withdrawal symptoms instead. So that would certainly take discretion. How to screen? There's one. McClellan presented in 2010 just a 2 to 3 question harmful substance use screening tool, and found with that they actually found a prevalence rate of 20 to 50% across healthcare and 60% of all ER admissions in his publication from 2010. I know the Maryland Department of Health had put a single sheet where one could screen together for alcohol and substance abuse, intimate partner violence, and tobacco use, and be able to link the three of those together in one screen. One of the oldest ways of screening has been the CAGE self-reporting screen, which was initially set up for alcohol use, and is divided into cut down, annoy, guilty, eye opener. Have you ever felt that you should cut down on your own drinking? Have people annoyed you by criticizing your drinking? Have you ever felt guilty? And have you ever needed an eye opener? And CAGE-8 basically asks the similar questions, but about alcohol or drug use. And any single positive answer should prompt further evaluation. And there are many other self-reporting screens as well out there. Screening for prescription drug abuse. It's very important that patients list all medications recently prescribed, including those given prior to pregnancy that may have been discontinued when the patient found out she was pregnant. And also, it's helpful to check the PDMP and see what has been prescribed. If there have been multiple prescribers, a lot of prescribers other than treating physicians, that should be a red flag. Also, patients who with prescription drug abuse will often complain of multiple drug allergies and side effects, and will state that all non-prescription therapies for whatever the ailment is have been ineffective. There's also an increased risk of the presence of substance abuse in under the following circumstances, which can also be red flags. When patients have late initiation or no prenatal care, have multiple missed prenatal visits, if you know of impaired school or work performances, have poor obstetrical history. And then if their children have either neurodevelopmental behavioral problems, or they're not living with the mother or have been involved with child protective services. It's also a red flag if there's a history of drug alcohol mediated problems. If a patient, you have a young woman that presents with pancreatitis, bacterial endocarditis, suspicious trauma, or has skin abscesses, a family history of substance abuse, or a partner who is a substance abuser should lead to further questions. And then lastly, if a patient has had frequent encounters with law enforcement agencies. ESPERT, which stands for Screening, Brief Intervention, and Referral to Treatment, has gained a lot of interest and has resulted in a lot of training over the last, I'd say, more than 10 years. And it's basically comprehensive and integrated approach to delivering, to both identifying and then delivering early intervention and treatment services through universal screening for people with substance use disorder and those at risk. It does cast a fairly wide net that then needs to be narrowed down. And just examples of the interaction, they start from what's more least threatening to the patient as to what their parents, whether their parents were involved with alcohol and drugs, whether their partner is, whether they have had past use of alcohol or illicit drugs or misused prescription drugs, and then in this current pregnancy, in the month before you knew you were pregnant, what cigarettes did you smoke? What alcohol did you consume? you use illicit or misused prescription drugs. And then each woman with a positive 4P screen underwent immediate assessment for substance use through a standardized structured clinical interview. And from there, a positive assessment is defined as having substance use disorder, and patient is provided information and then offered a referral. So implementation of ESPRT certainly requires specific training and protocols in place in one's practice. But what are the goals? And even in discussing why you're screening or referring for treatment with a patient, and it's very important to emphasize that the goals are cessation of the illicit drug use, but also to stabilize, sorry, the intrauterine environment, stabilize the patient's environment, increase compliance with prenatal care and substance abuse treatment, programming and counseling, and enhance pregnancy outcomes. Many times patients may come very frustrated to me because they're already on methadone and buprenorphine and actually want to titrate down in pregnancy, and most providers will not do that. Then we have conversations about the importance of keeping the intrauterine environment stable, the patient's environment stable, and preventing relapse during the pregnancy. Are transitioning to using the term medication for opioid use disorder or MOUD instead of medication-assisted therapy or MAT, by focusing on the fact that buprenorphine, methadone are treatments for the disorder. They're not just adjuncts. And as we don't refer to insulin as assisted treatment, it's treatment itself. And the goal, of course, is treatment, then sustained recovery, prevention of opioid overdose. And currently in pregnancy, we are usually only using methadone and buprenorphine. Now, naltrexone has been studied elsewhere, as in specifically in Australia. I've only have recommended continuing that in pregnancy when a patient has failed methadone and buprenorphine and has been stabilized only on naltrexone, in which case I would not discontinue it. I just want to talk briefly about opioid detoxification in pregnancy. And although it has been done under various protocols in pregnancy under direct medical supervision, it's not advised either by the American Congress of OBGYN or the American Society of Addiction Medicine, largely because of the high failure rate in maintaining a drug-free status, which can be anywhere from 50% to 90%. There are concerns about in-utero fetal detoxification, although it doesn't appear to result in fetal death in utero. The big concern about the high failure rate is the patients go through a detoxification, then they relapse, and then it can be a month or two or three before they re-engage in treatment. And with the limited time frame of pregnancy, you don't want to lose that time. However, we will in our program take care of detoxification. For following reasons. Some patients are very insistent on detoxification, and if it is the hook that will bring them into treatment, it may be worthwhile. What I do when we do, I always tell them that they have the option of switching from detoxing to maintenance. And I would say about half of our patients actually do switch from detoxification to maintenance. either during the process of detoxification or afterwards. For some patients, they don't have any access to buprenorphine or methadone close enough to their residence. And it has been requirements of some long-term residential or intensive outpatient treatment programs to have patients opioid-free prior to admission. In the state of Maryland, any of the state-funded programs are required to accept patients who are on medication for opioid use disorder, but that may not be true for all the private programs. Methadone, and we know that comprehensive methadone maintenance treatment includes prenatal care, and it reduces the risk of obstetric and fetal complications in utero growth retardation and neonatal morbidity and mortality. And I quote this study, which is way back from 1991. So this is methadone has been the gold standard of treating opioid use disorder in pregnancy for the last 30 years. And buprenorphine, which has really only been used in pregnancy over the last 12 years, has the same results in reducing complications. And again, methadone maintenance, and this is also studies from the late 1990s, has been shown to reduce the fluctuation in maternal serum opioid levels. So the fetus is not going through repetitive withdrawal episodes. It eliminates the need for illicit opioid use. And with fentanyl overwhelming the market right now, that's a major concern, not only of providers, but patients as well. It reduces neonatal morbidity and mortality and results in increased birth weight. And you get the same type of results for buprenorphine has been shown on multiple studies over the last 10 years. So that's one of the why for screening. Well, another important thing is documentation in the prenatal records. Document what screening method you used, what was the result of the screen, if it is positive, to whom was a referral made, what discussion was had with the patient, and then lastly, did the patient follow up? As someone who has abstracted multiple charts on these patients, I can't tell you how many charts say screening, yes. And that's all I have in the documentation. I don't have any information about whether the screen was positive or negative, or if it was positive, what was done about the positive screen. And that's really important, especially in making sure patients have follow-up care. And then for any chart review, we're trying to figure out what happened during the pregnancy. So next, I want to talk about modifying prenatal care for this population. So one of the biggest challenges in providing care, as you know, is stigma. And we just had a very good talk during the ECHO this past week on stigma. And one of the things I discovered very early on in my medical career was the tremendous prejudice towards drug-addicted pregnant women, both within society and within the healthcare system. There's a very good video available called Words Matter, and it's very important that the whole staff is on board. Every single patient I have seen with substance use disorder has had adverse attitudes that they've had to deal with when they had interacted with the healthcare system. And so it's really important to have an accepting environment for this patient population. The other challenges in providing care is there's often limited or no reimbursements for additional services that are often needed. Within either an obstetrical practice, a methadone program, or the practice clinic providing buprenorphine therapy. And so sometimes you're doing a certain amount of non-reimbursable work in order to care for these patients, and that is definitely a challenge. These patients have a lot of challenges in accessing care, which one has to take into consideration. Often they start out pregnancy with a lack of medical insurance and necessary documents to obtain medical insurance, even though many of them may be are eligible for medical assistance. And so often if they find out they're pregnant at 8 to 10 weeks, it's another 4 weeks to get their documents in order, and then often another 4 weeks to get in for prenatal care. So that can be a real challenge in trying to access prenatal care early. Patients with opioid use disorder often have poor organizational skills, poor executive functioning, which makes keeping appointments, attending therapy challenging. There's a high incidence of homelessness and unemployment. And I'll come back to some of these challenges. Many of these patients have very poor social supports. You see a lot of multi-generational drug abuse across, again, all socioeconomic strata. And lack of transportation is a major issue, as well as lack of childcare. And in general, most treatment programs don't have any facilities for any childcare, and that's a major problem. A number of these patients have either grown up in or experienced violent social environments, and the incidence of child molestation and intimate partner violence can be as high as 60% in this patient population. And then there are a lot of family problems, unstable partners, other family members, often caring for children that aren't their own. So, what are some of our goals in treating opioid use disorder, substance use disorder, and pregnancy? Well, we want to improve pregnancy outcomes. The number one complication of substance use disorder in pregnancy is preterm delivery, and that cuts across all substances of abuse. Lower risk of low birth weight is a goal, in utero fetal death. We'd like to lower emergency cesarean delivery for non-reassuring fetal status. And we'd like to eliminate maternal, fetal, and infant risk from contaminant drugs found in street heroin, fentanyl, etc. And we want to lower the risk of SIDS, also increased in this population. And then lastly, we want to encourage the patient to avoid other street drugs, cocaine, benzodiazepines, that also compromise pregnancy outcomes. So I would advocate for what I call enhanced prenatal care. So it's routine prenatal care plus some of the following features. First, it's important to establish pregnancy dating as early as possible in this patient population. Patients who have a history of active use often have irregular periods and just poor menstrual dating. One may want to consider more frequent prenatal visits, especially after the initial visit. You may want, if you do not have the initial labs or an ultrasound, you may want to see them back in 2 weeks rather than 4 weeks until all of the initial evaluation is actually completed. Obtaining additional labs. I check all these patients for hepatitis C. I do a hepatitis B surface antibody in addition to the antigen. I do a total hepatitis A. And if then they are negative for both antibody and antigen, I can offer immunization and vaccines against hepatitis B and A. Often we'll also check their thyroid function because up to 75% of these patients have coexisting psychiatric disorders, and you want to make sure that their thyroid status is normal. We also do a comprehensive metabolic panel, specifically looking at their liver function tests, and then vitamin D levels that can certainly be decreased in any chronic disease. In addition to Dehning ultrasounds, nuchal translucency ultrasounds, and the fetal anatomy ultrasound, I recommend obtaining a third trimester growth ultrasound because we know this patient population has a increased risk for fetal growth restriction. I also do frequent screening of these patients, both for preterm labor as well as preeclampsia, and also keeping an eye out for outside hospitalizations. Many of these patients, when they have complaints, will go to the nearest hospital, which may not be the hospital that you're affiliated with. And so one needs to ask about making sure that there haven't been any other hospitalizations between visits. Routinely, there's no need for field testing unless there are other OB medical indications. And there's one caveat with that, which I'll discuss in a few minutes. If one does want increased surveillance for STIs, oops, sorry, we repeat HIV screening with third trimester labs as well as with the initial prenatal labs. And one of the things which we've also instituted is if the patient has declined HIV screening, I actually will place that on the problem list because we've had at least a couple of episodes over the years where patients suspected they were HIV positive and yet declined screening, and that was not followed up until delivery when we found out that she was HIV positive. We do check for gonorrhea and chlamydia not only at the time of first prenatal visit, but also when we do the group B strep evaluation at 36 weeks. And then we also do increased STI screening for known exposures and for patients who are also working as sex workers. And this population is fairly upfront about saying, I've been exposed, please evaluate me for STIs. Or that they are exchanging drugs for sex, et cetera. I talked about the vaccinations. And then also to be aggressive in support, offering supporting meds for constipation, heartburn, nausea, and vomiting. This is not a population that tends to go to the drugstore and just get over-the-counter medications. And then just resources for specific obstacles. With such a problem with transportation, often medical transportation is provided by the county or the patient's MCO, but often needs like a 3-day notice for provision. There's these 500 forms that you may need to fill out for the patient to qualify. Loss of contact. Because of homelessness, using burner phones, etc. And so it's really useful when you first have these see these patients to make sure you also have contact information for family or friends who can find that patient when they no longer are at the address or phone number that you have. Reminding patients of appointments sometimes is going to be actually useful because it's easier to remind the patient of an upcoming appointment than to keep rescheduling that appointment. Ensure the patient is obtaining the prescribed meds. Co-pays, pre-authorizations can be a real impediment to patients actually taking prescribed meds. And then lastly, really screening for intimate partner violence. Unfortunately, homicide and intimate partner violence can increase in during pregnancy, and especially in unplanned pregnancy. And then lastly, within this section, educating patients on neonatal opioid withdrawal syndrome, and whether you provide some education in your own office, give them a pamphlet, or refer them to a pediatrician or neonatologist for a consultation, it's important to provide basic education on my okay.
Yeah, this slide's just turned off for a second, so I'm just gonna adjust that.
Okay, just technical question for a moment. Were they able to see my other slides?
Yeah, it's odd that that just happened, but we should be okay now. There you go. Sorry about that, everyone.
Okay. So, neonatal opioid withdrawal syndrome, or NAO, is also called neonatal absence syndrome, or NAS. Most infants exposed to opioids in utero have some degree of NAS, whether or not they require medication. And what's important to know is that for methadone, also true for buprenorphine, the majority of studies that look at maternal dose have not shown a relationship between the actual methadone dose and either severity or the duration of this withdrawal syndrome. So when patients come to me and they want to go down on their dose for the sake of the infant, I actually try to redirect them and say, how about making sure you're not on any other medications and cutting back on your nicotine use, which we'll also talk about in a moment. So this is actually older slide, which says every 25 minutes a baby's born suffering from opioid withdrawal. It's more every 18, 19 minutes now. And it gained a lot of attention because, as you can see on the bottom left, the increased average length or cost of hospital stay of infants with neonatal absence syndrome is far greater than for infants that do not have neonatal absence syndrome. Now, having said that, it's very easy, especially on the state or financial level, to say, can we decrease the incidence of neonatal absence syndrome? And that really isn't the goal unless you're going to have all patients off opioids prior to conception, which would be a societal challenge. However, there are things we can do to decrease the length of stay. And one of those is having patients not on any other medications of abuse and limiting nicotine. So, with neonatal opioid withdrawal syndrome, all of these infants are evaluated on a regular basis for the first 4 to 5 days of life, and patients should be aware of that ahead of time. There are various ways that these infants are evaluated historically, and in many cases, still today. The modified Finnegan scoring system is used. Newer, there's been the Eat, Sleep, Console protocol. And there are people who use something intermediate between those two. And it's good to know which protocol your hospital is using. Only a subset of these infants actually require medication for NAS. In general, various studies will say somewhere between 40 and 50%. The average length meds are required is 12 days, but some infants just need a little bit of medication to get over a hump of withdrawal symptoms, and occasionally you'll have an infant that will require hospitalization for a couple months because of withdrawal. In general, the babies do not need to be in the NICU for withdrawal unless they are having significant, they're not feeding or have severe symptomatology. Medications used include morphine and clonidine are the most common, and some places will use weight-based versus symptom-based dosing. And one other thing that's really important is non-pharmacologic treatment is appropriate for all opioid-exposed infants until the infant appears well integrated. So it's really would be very helpful if all these women who are using opioids during pregnancy have some training in some of these non-pharmacologic treatments, because even after the infant goes home, if it's been on medication, it may continue to have some evidence of withdrawal that the parents are going to need to deal with. An important thing to emphasize is that NAS or NAS itself is actually self-limiting. However, especially if the infant is severely withdrawing, the mothers have a very hard time dealing with that. They feel very guilty about it. It can lead to relapse, and is something that really would bears observation and close monitoring of these mothers. And these are mothers I really would see back for an early prenatal visit to see how they are coping.
Dr. Melio,
Yes.
we have an NAS specific question. Someone in the chat
Yes.
asked, does nursing the baby decrease the degree of NAS?
There are studies that say that nursing is does decrease that it's beneficial. I don't know that how quant well, I haven't seen anything quantified that way, but we do encourage nursing if the patient is not using any other drugs, but you can certainly breastfeed on buprenorphine and on methadone. And nursing is often very soothing for the infant and is part of some of these non-pharmacologic ways of dealing with the of dealing with the symptomatology. So, now having said that, different hospitals will have said that a patient has to be drug-free on admission to labor and delivery, or for 30 days or 45 days prior to delivery. So some hospitals have some rules on who they allow to breastfeed while in the hospital, but in general, it's encouraged. Just wanted to have this one slide. The mother study that was published in 2010 specifically looked at buprenorphine in pregnancy, and it actually showed that the infants exposed to buprenorphine in pregnancy versus methadone during pregnancy, although about the same number statistically required treatment, the amount of morphine needed was much less. And the mean hospital stay and duration of treatment were significantly less. And when we look at methadone and buprenorphine in pregnancy, they're both efficacious in preventing relapse to illicit drug opioid use. Buprenorphine may result in less fetal cardiac and movement suppression than methadone, and less severe NAS NAS relative to methadone. However, buprenorphine is not appropriate for all patients. Some patients don't tolerate buprenorphine, and for other patients, it has not been effective, or their level of dependency is such that they do need methadone. I want to just circle back a little bit to nicotine withdrawal syndrome. And in utero exposure to nicotine may worsen NAS. And that is of concern, since anywhere between 80 and 93% of women who have opioid use disorder also use tobacco. So strategizing with patients on decreasing and stopping nicotine products should be part of prenatal care, and refocusing patients, as I stated earlier, away from decreasing methadone or buprenorphine to actually decreasing or stopping their nicotine use. And then I want to talk for a few minutes about establishing communication with the substance use disorder, opioid use disorder treatment providers. And, care of the pregnant women with OUD, SUD is really a multidisciplinary effort in order to optimize both perinatal outcome and maternal sobriety. So it really does involve prenatal care, evaluation and treatment for comorbidities, psychiatric, medical, substance abuse treatment and counseling, often nutritional counseling, social service involvement, and pediatric follow-up. And coordination of care is an important part of that. So it's important to establish upfront with the patient that you want to have permission to have contact with the patient's OUD or SUD treatment provider in order to optimize and coordinate care, and emphasizing this is not for punitive reasons, since many of these patients may be suspicious of why you want to have contact. There is a special consent form for contacting these providers, or for that matter, even contacting a psychiatric provider. And unless you have faxed the consent, these treatment programs will not even acknowledge whether or not your patient is in their program. Have a mechanism in place to receive and provide updates and communication. And it's really helpful to have mutual support with other providers in caring for the shared patients. And so I don't think of it as any different than having communication with an endocrinologist if you're co-managing a type 1 diabetic, or, et cetera. And lastly, here I want to talk about handling the unstable patient with OUD or SUD. And, some patients are unwilling or unable to stop illicit drugs, alcohol, for a variety of reasons. And these are some of the ones I have run across. One, some patients just have no hope of success. They have been using for over 20 years. They've had multiple, been through multiple treatment programs. They have always relapsed. They've had minimum times of sobriety. And it's really hard to persuade them that this time could be different. A few patients may just not be invested in the pregnancy. They discover they're pregnant when they're 25 weeks along, don't have an option of terminating, and are not planning to parent that child. We see some patients who don't feel capable of parenting. And what we've seen occasionally is patients who are doing well in pregnancy and then relapse in the third trimester. And in some ways, while I'm talking to these patients, they don't feel capable of parenting, but they don't want to make the decision to give the baby up for foster care or for adoption. And so they almost have the system make that decision for them by using very late in pregnancy. And it's very frustrating for us as providers, but I've seen that happen from time to time. Some patients just don't seem to be able to abide by rules and restrictions of treatment programs. Patients who have been living for years on the street are used to interactions there, have a hard time with anger management, psychiatric comorbidity, etc., and therefore end up being expelled from treatment program after treatment program, and that can be problematic. And no one, and often without actually addressing the behavior that's causing it. There's a lot of social pressure not to be on medication, methadone or buprenorphine, And some patients may find it easier to hide the use of the illicit drugs rather than be on regular medications that family will know about. There can be a lack of support, goes along with social pressure for use. If you are living with someone who's an active user, it's very hard to be abstinent. Some patients have untreated psychiatric illness, and going along with that, also, some patients are just very disorganized and they just want to follow up for treatment, but they just never quite do it. So, how do we manage the unstable patient? I think it's real important to meet with the patient to discuss what their particular barriers to treatment are. You may need to have more frequent visits and even have phone contact with the staff so that they feel that your office is a safe place for them and a place where they can contact if they're in trouble. These are patients where you may consider field testing because there is an increased risk of pregnancy loss in these patient populations. You may want to elicit cooperation of support persons in their life or involve a case manager for their particular MCO. You may also want to discuss referral to residential treatment. And in many times, we have found women who are continuing to use, who resist going to residential treatment until they realize that Child Protective Services is going to require residential treatment in order for them to maintain custody of the infant. And then lastly, I do consider inducing labor at 37 weeks for these patients who are oftentimes missing visits and are actively using. I'm just going to briefly mention the program that I've been part of for the last 20 years, the Center for Addiction and Pregnancy. And it's a one-stop shopping program where we include obstetrical evaluation and care, including high-risk obstetrical care and HIV care. We have substance use disorder treatment, methadone, buprenorphine maintenance, and including intensive outpatient programming. We have psychiatric consultation and special counseling for domestic violence and PTSD counseling. We do have a pediatric clinic. We have a 16-bed residential housing unit, and we do work closely with the addiction medicine unit at Johns Hopkins Bayview for inpatient detoxification for opioids, benzos, alcohol. We take patients for the duration of the pregnancy and through a year now postpartum. And we also do for patients who live remotely, we have taken patients for just a few weeks to stabilize them before they return to their own community. So, you know, our roles as OBGYNs is really important in impacting the epidemic of addiction as primary and specialty care providers for women of all ages, but especially during pregnancy. And so pregnancy is a time when individuals with substance use disorder are often motivated to make changes and engage in treatment. And it is a challenge, I will not deny, to participate in treatment, but may we really embrace this challenge and also, you know, line up the resources that we need to help us as we care for these patients. Thank you, and be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Melio. It is 12:29, so before I read those questions out, I do just want to give one more reminder to look out at the email that you registered with for a copy of the slides, as well as a link to the evaluation survey. And please allow 1 to 2 business days after you complete that survey to receive your certificate. So we have two questions that came up when you were talking about NOWS. And can you just give us a little bit more information on marijuana withdrawal. And do you allow the nicotine patch during pregnancy?
Okay, so let me address the second thing. Yes, we do use the nicotine patch gum lozenges during pregnancy as preferable to actual tobacco smoking or even vaping, because at least it's a single substance that they're being exposed to, and not the hundreds of other substances that are in both tobacco and as well as in vaping liquid. None of those seem to be as effective as Chantix, but Chantix is not yet approved for pregnancy, and I'm not sure it's going to be for the near future. And so we do allow other. We do all the other forms of nicotine replacement in pregnancy. As far as cannabis in pregnancy, and it may contribute, there is a cannabis withdrawal syndrome, but it's much more poorly defined than opioid withdrawal syndrome. We know that cannabis can have a negative impact on brain development from the prenatal period through 25 years of age, because that whole time period, the brain is still actively maturing and growing, etc. It's controversial about breastfeeding while using cannabis, everywhere from yes, you may breastfeed on cannabis to no, you should not breastfeed. And so there's a wide range of opinion on actual recommendation in terms of breastfeeding for cannabis. And that's a whole cannabis and talk in pregnancy and postpartum is almost another at least half talk. But that's would be my short answer there.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Dr. Milio. And I agree, that topic is probably the most requested topic we've seen on the mom side of things. So I did put a link to our previous webinars. One of them was on cannabis use in pregnancy. I definitely suggest checking out that recording. I'm not seeing any other questions in the chat. Please take a couple more minutes if you do have questions to put those in now. If we cannot address.
I was just going to say, just one additional comment on the cannabis.
Okay.
There's various levels of use. I mean, there's the patient who smokes a blunt a couple times a week, and then there are patients who are using pots of cannabis every day. So when we talk about cannabis use, there's a wide range in quantity, and that certainly would impact one's recommendations. No, I'm sorry, I just wanted to interject that.
No, thank you so much. I'm not seeing any other questions in the chat. I know we're a couple minutes over, so I will say that if you have more patient-specific questions or just want other questions around best practices or policies to enforce, please call our warm line. I did put our number in the chat. Our consultants, like Dr. Milio, are here to help you, and that's a great way to get personalized help for what you are specifically looking for. But thank you
And
all for.
if you have any other specific questions having to do with this talk, you can certainly contact me through Max for Moms.
Definitely. So thank you all for attending. I'm seeing some great feedback in the chat. Feel free to log off and just look out for those follow-up emails. Thanks all.